So this is Cisco Heat, a game where the player takes the role of an officer who must race his squad car to San Francisco in an attempt to win the first ever national championship police car steeplechase. Yeah. Now the gameplay is pretty similar to other games of the time. You have a basic two-speed shifter and you view the car from behind in the chase view. The key difference between this game and other racing games of the time is that this was the very first one to have 90 degree turns, which to be honest, do kinda hinder the gameplay. I can't help but feel if this game did not have those 90 degree turns, it would be so much more fun. But as it is, Cisco Heat is a pretty interesting concept and one that certainly stood out in the arcades back in its day. So let's start off our look at the ports with the ZX Spectrum version. Now, of course, you're not going to get an arcade looking game on the ZX Spectrum. And to be honest, this game doesn't even really play like the arcade game. But if you forget that this is an arcade conversion and just take it for what it is, the ZX Spectrum game is not that bad actually. It moves at a fairly decent frame rate, the controls are kind of responsive, and to be honest, graphically, it doesn't look that bad. Unfortunately, all the home ports suffer from the same problem with the controls. I don't know why they did this back in the day, but pretty much all racing games have the same problem on home computers or Western home computers. You have one fire button. Now, in my opinion, that fire button should be used for accelerate, and if you want to brake, just take your finger off the fire button. But nope, you've got to use gears as well. Okay, so you got a bit of a problem. Ideally, they would use the fire button for accelerate, let go for brake, and just have the game running in automatic mode so there's no gears. But in this game, and pretty much all the versions, you have to push forward to accelerate, which makes it really difficult to turn corners. So the fire button is probably used for gears, you're thinking. Well, nope, the fire button just sounds your horn. What a waste of a button. To change gears, you gotta reach over to the keyboard and hit the enter key. So the Amstrad CPC version is basically a port of the ZX Spectrum version, but now they've colored it in. And to be honest, it doesn't look too bad, it looks quite nice. But as you'd expect, being a CPC game, the frame rate is quite low, which results in quite a choppy game. This choppiness doesn't do the game any favors in the control department either, because everything seems to feel quite sluggish. In fact, the game is extremely tough. The time limit on this version, and to be honest pretty much all the versions, is extremely tight, meaning the only way you can actually finish the first stage is by doing a perfect run. We'll be right back. So here we go with the Commodore 64 version, and all I can say is this game is a cluster f- of mess. I mean, you got all over the screen, and you can't even tell if you're going forwards or backwards most of the time. Cars just appear, disappear, randomly pop in and out of the road. It is just a complete and utter unplayable joke of a port. In fact, I like it because it's so terrible. But to the game's defense, they did get one thing right. They put the gear change onto the fire button, so there's no need to reach over to the keyboard to change gears. It's still a f***ing mess though. So here we go with the first of the 16-bit ports, and it's the Amiga version. And first impressions are good. Sprite scaling is not too bad, there's lots of enemy cards on screen at once, and it runs at a fairly reasonable frame rate. Not an excellent frame rate, but you know, reasonable. The problem is, this game doesn't play anything like the arcade version. In fact, none of them do. So again, you have to take it with a grain of salt that it's an arcade conversion. But in its own right, it's not a bad game. So here we go with the Atari ST version. And now you may be thinking, hey, it looks like the Amiga version but faster. Well, that's because the Amiga version is a conversion of this. So the ST game plays pretty much like the Amiga version, but now runs a lot faster, and as a result, it's a lot more fun to play. But that strict time limit is still present, making it very difficult to even complete the first stage. Apart from that though, this is a pretty enjoyable game. Nothing says quality like a full screen with a tiny gameplay window in the center. Yes, this is the MS-DOS version, and while it does move pretty nicely, it plays in a tiny little box. Yeah. The game actually comes with a couple of different display modes, such as a VGA, which you're seeing now, CGA and EGA. You can also choose between different audio modes as well, such as the Adlib, the Roland, or the internal speaker. The sound you're hearing at the moment is actually coming from the internal speaker. Gameplay wise, this is probably the best one to play. The controls seem much more responsive than the ST, which was pretty good, and a lot more responsive than the Amiga. Unfortunately, playing in that tiny window might put a few people off. But if you can get over that fact, the MS-DOS version of Cisco Heat is a pretty good racer. And let's take a look at all those versions of Cisco Heat running side by side.